Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to introduce to you Frankenstein from Tale Lords and Phil Savage from PC Gamer. We're going to talk to you about Mountain Blade 2 Bannerlord.
Okay, everyone. So who here has played a Mountain Blade game before? Oh, that's a lot of hands. Okay, but a few weren't raised. So I guess before we kick off, do you want to just sort of explain what Mountain Blade is?
Most people seem pretty familiar with the game already, but just for those of you who don't know, Mountain Blade, it's a medieval sandbox game, and it incorporates elements of action, RPG, strategy, and simulation. So it's a sort of very unique mix of different gameplay genres. There's a lot of role-playing. It's quite a hardcore PC game, and we're very pleased to be showing it here in this kind of format because we get to talk about it, hopefully get some of your questions at the end as well. And it's please just bear in mind, this is a live demo. This is the current game, and it's its current state. There might be a bug or two. But hopefully everything goes well, and there's a lot of new stuff here that we're showing you from Bannerlord.
Excellent.
Okay, so I'm going to be over to the computer right now. We're both going to be playing and talking about it as we go through the demo. And Phil's going to be asking us some questions throughout. If I can just navigate my way here. Okay.
Do we have sound?
Do we have audio? All right. Okay, so have you set the day? Special settings being put into place. PC Gamer Day 1.
I take it our code won't work in the live game.
Okay, let's jump into a new game. What we're actually doing is loading a save game here. We're going to tell you what we're doing and where we're headed with it once we get started with the demo. But the first thing we want to do is we want to make ourselves a face to play for the demo with.
Right, so, okay. So this is a feature that we're very excited about and have worked a lot on. It's a big part of role-playing to be able to change your character's appearance. So we've had really fun making our customizable options detailed and realistic. It's still a work in progress, but it's turning out just like we want it. And one of our goals have been to give the user absolute control, just like any other Mountain Blade feature. We have body type sliders, two of them, to change the body build and body weight. And we also have ability to change our skin color, age, and voice even, which is cool in multiplayer. And we also divided up the GUI. We designed it so that we can have quick results by randomizing all, and we can also go into specific parts of the face and randomize them on their own, which is very useful for creating, for example, unique eyes, so you get your eyes. So another thing that is completely new in Bannerlord is animations on the face. It's not fully implemented everywhere in the game yet, but it's all laid out in the engines, so we can support this in conversations and in battle, basically everywhere we want. Of course, we also allow every player to customize their character fully in multiplayer. So you will all have access to this tool, and this is the tool we use to create our unique characters in Bannerlord as well, and also our generated characters. So to demonstrate a little bit of the power we have in this character customization in Bannerlord so far, I prepared a few faces, and let's go through them. Maybe you can recognize one of them. And this guy. Let's go with this one.
So you can see we've really put together a very powerful tool. And this is really important for us when we're developing the game because as Stan mentioned, every single character in the game uses the same system, so we need that diversity and also the ability to make charismatic, interesting characters as well. Obviously, the animation, again, since it's a generic system, we can animate all the characters in our game, and that's the benefit of using a standardized system for all the characters as well. Okay.
This is our Fast and Furious character.
Yeah.
Let's see. We also have this guy.
Okay.
Maybe it doesn't leave. Let's have as you can see, we're already able to create very cool looking characters, and we're so looking forward to see our creative players' own creations. And we will make this tool so that it's easy for every player to save their own faces and also share them in between each other.
Okay, let's
Have Phil choose a character, maybe.
Yeah, any preferences?
Any one you like specifically that we should continue on as?
We'll continue with the Star Wars vibe. That's good.
Looks good.
Okay, cool.
All right, let's jump back into the game then. All right, so now that we've got our game face on, let's take you a little bit through about what you can see here right now. If we zoom out, this is the overworld map, right? So it's the same as the previous games. We have an overworld map. It's Calradia, but expanded more to the east and to the south. The names on the map represent the different factions, the different settlements and towns, and so they're color-coded by the different kingdoms. Over on the west, we have the Kingdom in Red, which is Vlandia. It's sort of our Western European-inspired faction. They have heavy knights and sort of chivalric-type medieval faction there. We're actually at war with them in our current save. We're a vassal of the Southern Empire. So what our plan is to head over to this faction and have a big battle with the Lord, take them out and advance the Southern Empire war effort. So let's jump back to our character.
Sounds good.
And this is our party. You can see we have four people in the party, represented by the number four. It's purple for the Southern Empire. But this is not a big enough army to fight a battle with, right? So we've got to go get a garrison. It's over in the town of Ortizia, just south of this river. The way movement works is, when we click on the map, time progresses, right? So it's simultaneous movement, same as the previous games. And when we stop, time pauses, just the same as the previous games. Let's head over towards Ortizia then and pick up our troops. There's a new feature actually in Bannerlord as well. You can garrison your troops in different towns, allied towns. They'll also help defend it in a siege. And it allows you to go and take care of a personal task or a quest, move around with a smaller party if you need to.
And is that like an automated process then, if you've garrisoned someone and they attack?
Yeah, if your garrison is in an allied town, they'll join the defense in the siege. Okay, so what we've encountered here is a small party of bandits on our way to Ortizia. There's 16 of them. We consider they're looters. We're slightly outnumbered, but since looters tend to run around in sort of tattered rags with kitchen knives and that kind of thing, we should be able to take them down.
Let's we can get take them.
Yeah, we can take them. Trusting in Sten's ability to do so as well. Okay, so we're going to threaten them and get straight into this fight. We have a bit of information before the battle as well. We can see details about those troops. We're going to cover that more later in the big battle as well, because there's more to show off. All right, so this is an example of a small battle in the game. And as I mentioned before, it's action, RPG, strategy, and simulation. So essentially what you have in the battles is the action portion of the game, right? It's still an RPG in the sense that you develop your character, you choose your equipment and weapons and that sort of thing. But when it comes to the battles, it's very much player skill. You fire an arrow. If that arrow hits, that's what does damage. Nothing to do with your character. It's purely based on what you do as a player. We've got a few buddies with us, and we've got a nice big two-handed sword. We have a bow and a horse, so we're pretty well equipped. Obviously, we have a lot of different options in the game. You can, a great variety of different medieval weaponry that you can use. We can be hot mounted, dismounted, and we have a very direct combat system where, you know, same as the previous games, but even more advanced. The direction that you choose with the mouse, that's how you're going to swing. It's the same with blocking as well. Very much involved. One new. Oh my god! No!
I got this!
Oh god!
Oh no! Take them down! Okay, so our advanced AI right now is basically taking us out. Well, one of our new features is that because we have this big two-handed sword, if we land it right, we can actually hit multiple opponents with one swing. We're getting butchered right now.
Stop it!
Okay.
There we go.
Yes!
Yes!
Go. Oh, it's a massacre.
Just about. We really had to carry our companions right there. They evaporated at the start of the battle. All right. Thank you. Good job, Steph.
Yeah, very good.
Okay, so before we move on, I mentioned we had the direct control, so it's still the blocking and attacking. We choose a direction, and it's very, very intuitive, but it's also very deep as well. We have players that have spent hundreds, thousands of hours even mastering and perfecting their abilities in the system. We get some information after the battle as well, the post-battle results. There's quite a lot of detail here as well. You can see Hamazan did okay, but the rest of our companions got completely wiped out, and we really had to carry that battle. Okay, so our enemies that were fortunate enough to get knocked out, we can take those prisoner, and it's a life of slavery for them when we sell them on later. We can also take their some of their weapons and goods. We actually have a crafting piece here that we can loot as well. Let's grab this.
We're going to go into crafting
later. We'll
talk
about that later, yeah. Okay, that's perfect. So we can also just take the loot, equip ourselves directly. Let's head towards Tissia. Okay, so I mentioned that that was a bandit party. What bandits essentially do, and the reason that we kill them in the game, is because bandits are basically bullies, right? They pick on parties smaller than them. That generally means peasants, farmers, and this causes a problem for us because we really need our peasants and farmers to be making the trip from their villages to the towns, selling their goods, and that's what fuels our economy. As the peasants take their goods to the towns, they get manufactured to secondary goods, sold at the marketplace, and we take a cut of those profits. So we really need all the cogs of our economy working in the simulation to have enough money to pay the wages for our soldiers and then take on the larger battles as well.
Yeah, it's a fully dynamic process, right? So even if something's interrupted while you're not around, while you're doing something out, that will have an effect on the world.
Exactly, and the sort of the brilliant thing about this is as well, you can use this to your advantage, right? You can, if you don't like an enemy lord, you can go and harass all of his villagers, be a bandit yourself essentially, and you can starve his economy, and you'll see the results in the battle. You'll see that he has less troops, lower level troops, he can't afford to pay them, he can't afford to feed them, and everything has an effect, a knock-on effect in the sandbox game.
But it will make the battles against that lord easier down the line, yeah.
Exactly. Right, let's jump into a city, and Sten's going to take us through this.
All right, so on the world map, when we come to a city, a settlement, we get this menu, right? Yeah. With the options that we have. We can go directly to the tavern or join a tournament or visit the lord in his castle. And the reason we give these options here is because exploration is always a choice in Mountain Blade. And we do reward this in Bannerlord in different ways. And what we're going to do now is we're going to pick up a lord, companion, and a bunch of garrison troops that we left here with him. And he is in the tavern, we can see here. We also see a bunch of other information about the city, its walls, its garrison, and we're going to enter the tavern and then we're going to check out the marketplace.
Alright.
So one thing that we have been working on a lot and are still working on is atmosphere and detail in the cities and culture, of course. So companions, travelers and normal townspeople, they can come into taverns and they drink and they hang out with each other. And this is an imperial city then. So you'll see imperial clothes, hairstyles, and architecture all around the place. Even the board games that we have in this tavern, which you can play, is specific to its culture. And the musician is playing imperial music.
So each faction has their own like cultural touchstones that are reflected within the live environment.
Exactly, and it's also apparent on the battlefield in warfare, in different weapons and in combat styles. So this is our companion, we can talk to him. We're gonna ask him to rejoin our party with the troops, and we're also gonna ask him to follow us around in town. Because we're gonna need his support later.
Okay, so we've got our army back now, but we're gonna take a bit more of a look around the town and show you some of the ways in which you get rewarded for exploring and some of the sort of gameplay features we have within the town in Bannerlord. All right. So, Sten, I'll take over.
Yes.
Okay, so as we head out the tavern, we find ourselves in the marketplace. We're going to take a little look around this scene, but first of all, we want to get our companion to gather up the rest of our friends in the town. So the guys that we were fighting with before, they're now walking around the town, doing their own thing, and this companion's going to go find them all, gather them, and bring them to our side, and sort of we'll form up our gang. You see one of them has already found its way to us now.
And that feeds into the economy, right? As you gather more troops, you've got to deal with the supplies and and support all the armies that come in.
Yeah, yeah. We're now sort of having to feed them and pay their wages and all of that. This is the marketplace in this town. All of the scenes in the game are all unique. So every city has its own town area you can explore. And then they're all obviously culturally based as well. So there's a lot of variety. There's six different cultures in the game. You can explore all of them from the desert to the tundra. And in the marketplace, of course, we can buy and sell goods directly from here. You can also do that from the menus, whatever you want to do as the player.
Is there like a benefit to picking up troops from different cultures? Do they like interact in composition-wise? Do they interact in interesting ways there?
Yeah, of course. I mean, certain factions have different advantages. I mentioned before the Vlandian faction are enemies. They have particularly strong horsemen. The Empire faction that we're in right now, their advantage is diversity, so they sort of do a bit of everything. They have some good armor as well. They're a great faction to be a part of, especially if you like to experiment with different styles. Okay, so what we're going to show off now is
I'm waiting for my troops.
Okay, we're waiting for the rest of our guys to show up.
We only have two.
Some of them, they can be sometimes quite far away in the scene as well, but they'll get here soon.
So is that in like real time? Is he literally running to where the troops are?
Yeah, he's running and picking them all up. Okay, so what we have here, he's back himself now.
Here he comes.
Okay, so now we got a gang.
So what we're going to show off now is, by heading into this back alley, is a new feature. It's a highly requested feature and something we're excited about really as well. It's crime. And Sten's going to talk us through this a little bit.
So we see here that we're confronted by a group of thugs. What they've done here is that they've taken over this alley and they're running some sort of criminal activity here. And we're not going to take any back talk from them, so we're going to... what we can do is we can beat them up and make sure that they don't hang out there.
Go on, get him.
That was easy. So now that we clear this area of thugs, we also get the option to place one of our own companions here to guard it from other criminal activity to arise. And we can also, if we place the right kind of companion, we can start our own criminal activity here, which generates some sort of money to us. Now, we mentioned that this city belongs to the same faction as we belong to, and we have good relationship with the Lord. So this can, of course, cause a strain in our relationship, but we're going to do it anyway.
Why not?
Yeah.
So you can see we've taken over the alleyway, and all of our hired men are here, looking pretty tough. Okay, so I'm going to hand the reins back to Sten and talk a bit about the private enterprise feature that we have in our game. So I mentioned before that in the marketplace, you have a variety of sellers. All the sellers you find in the marketplace, they're essentially, they represent the town. So all the profits that they make go to the local lord. We also have in Bannerlord private enterprise. So this could be owned by not necessarily the local lord, a different lord in the faction, a lord from a different faction. They could be owned by merchants, even the player as well. And so this is it's a more legitimate way of making money, right, in the game. It's a more legitimate enterprise than taking part in crime. There's lots of different enterprises you can take part in as well. This one happens to be a blacksmith. We have sort of things like potters, weavers, armorsmiths, there's a whole bunch of them. Breweries, wineries. Because this is a blacksmith, what we can do is we can craft weapons here as well. We showed this feature off before, but now what we're going to do for the first time ever is make a weapon live on stage, and we're going to take it to the battle and use it to
get some Valandians.
Cut up some Valandian scum, yeah.
Yeah.
So the way crafting works, it's very Mountain Blade. It's we can take any different part, blade, guard, handle, and pommel. Any part fits with any other part, and you're also rewarded for exploring the world with this as well. So for instance, you might find in the Aserai Desert an interesting pommel that you like, take it with you, and when you head to the tundra in the north, find a blade, put that together and make your weapon. But it's not just visual either. Every single weapon has every single part has physical properties. And so you can combine these together in a way which maximizes the different properties of the weapon, right? So you can pick parts which go for maximum reach, maybe high damage, speed, whatever you want to do, or just try and find a balance. In addition, you can scale all of these parts as well. You can scale any of these parts as well. So what you basically have is a system which allows you for a tremendous amount of variation. And just like with the visual face customization, it's a standardized system. So all of the melee weapons in the game also now use this system. It's not just the player weapon. Any weapon you find there is going to be made up of different parts. So what you might do is you might take a lord prisoner, execute him, take his weapon, and then use that to kill his whole family as well. If you want to do that, you can totally do that within our game. It offers you that kind of freedom and depth. And we can also inspect it and take a good look at it in the inventory. Phil's Landian Cutter. You see, we're called Phil in the game as well.
Want to make an axe?
Let's make an axe as well, and we can give it to one of our companions. All right. Let's throw in a random.
Okay.
Another one. Okay, great.
This is
perfect, yeah.
I'm gonna just make it bigger.
Okay, so we can pick this weapon, directly buy it, equip it to our companions, and then I forgot to name it, but that's fine. We get the default name. And then they can just go ahead. Then they're gonna be ready for the fight.
Okay. Didn't work. Mark.
All right. So now we've got our weapon, we've got our troops. We're gonna head out of the town and head towards the enemy territory. Find a lord and get into a big battle.
Nice.
Okay. So we've got 65 troops now. That's not bad, but Valandia are pretty tough. So what we can do here is we can find an allied lord on the way, and we're going to speak to him and get him to follow us into the battle, right, to give us some extra power and a better chance in the fight. So this guy, Niphon, he's another lord in the same faction. We can get him to follow us, and before we do that, you can see in this dialogue option here, we have a hint of our new feature, which is called Influence. How this works is basically a new currency on the game, in addition to money and relation. What we can do is we can spend influence to get this guy to follow us, and it's a bit of like an IOU, right? So we can gain influence by doing work for our faction, spend it, and we can get some sort of command and get people to follow us and do various other tasks and requests like that. Okay, let's grab him and head towards Valandia.
So influence, that's faction dependent, right? That's,
yeah, faction dependent.
So just while we're traveling over, like, one of the things talking to you previously, you've said a lot about the game, is that you've tried to make information more easily accessible.
Yeah, we've worked so much on our...
Like, I assume, like, down the bottom there, everything's sort of within easy reach a lot more.
Yeah, right. I mean, you know, the previous game, it was pretty bare bones when it came to UI and the way we displayed information. So what we've done here was we presented on the world map extra information about how much food you have, morale, your current gold, troops, just some various useful little spots just to make it easier to play the game and just streamline the whole process of managing your party and your army. So now that we head towards Valandia, we're actually gonna fight this guy Ekerund, who's guarding the border. Go ahead.
Yeah, you should wait until morning.
Okay, go for it. So we're going to take you through now a sort of larger battle and show you the ways in which we've improved from the previous games. Obviously, because it's such a central part of the game, it's really important for us to work a lot on it and improve it as much as we possibly can. So Ekerund is going to give us a fairly hostile response because we're at war with him. But he's not necessarily going to attack us on sight. He might feel a bit threatened. We actually outnumber him slightly here. Although he's a bit of a tough old guy, so we might still have a bit of a fight on our hands.
Old
Let's just deliver our terms and get straight into the fight. Okay, so we showed you before the pre-battle screen. What we get here is a bit of extra information about the parties involved. We can see Ekerund, and obviously when you have some larger battles, you can have dozens of sort of lords on either side and then get the sort of much bigger fights occurring. Let's just jump in and attack and get into the fight. So obviously all these characters we've met as well, Ekerund and Niphon, they're all going to be in the fight themselves, fighting. Niphon's over there with our cavalry. Ekerund going to be on the other side. So Sten, what's your battle plan here?
First I want to see what the enemy does. They should be on the other side here, and I want to check out what they're doing.
There they are.
So we've really developed the battles a great deal from our previous games, as I mentioned, and we of course have more troops on the screen, more than we've ever had in any of our previous games. And on top of that, we've tried to make them much more deep and much more interesting as well. So it's not just about sort of the simple tactics we had in the previous games. Different lords have different behaviors, they have personalities, and they like to play in different ways, like to command their soldiers according to their personality, and that's reflected on the battlefield itself. In addition to that, lords are much more reactive, they're much more intelligent, so we have sort of much deeper battle gameplay here. We can see Niphon, our allied lord there, with the cavalry. What's your plan then, Sten? It seems like Ekerund is holding out on this hill.
Yeah, he is. Well, I will get in closer and choose a nearby hill myself.
So we have much more detail in the commands we can give as well. I mean, we can sort of draw out formations on the map, group them up in different ways. There's a great deal of improvement and advancement in actually just commanding the battle itself.
And the other lord that tagged along with you, do you have full control over those?
Because he's following us, we're the battle leader, and we have control of his troops, yeah. He's going to take part as one of the horsemen. So you can see we have obviously Empire troops here as well. So they have their sort of Imperial armors and weaponry. And obviously it's Mountain Blade. We have no kind of godlike fantasy powers. We're completely vulnerable in this fight as well, so we have to consider our own self-preservation as we're commanding our troops and moving around the battlefield. And one thing also that we have to mention here is that all of these troops, because it's a Mountain Blade game, they all have their own AI. So they're all fighting and deciding their own attacks and blocks and movement in their own way. There's nothing sort of it's not a general AI. It's all bit at the individual troops. And then we have obviously the level of AI, which is tactical as well, which is controlling the formations that are happening on the battlefield. There's a bunch of cool new AI features as well. So they have like self-preservation. So if they feel that like they're too far away from their buddies and their allied soldiers, they're going to run back into formation and sort of rethink what they're doing as well.
So what I want to do here is I see that there's a dip in the landscape in between these two hills. And I want to lure the other lord and some of his troops, or all of them, down here so that if I get the upper hand and they try to flee, they have to run upwards. And that way I can catch them better. So I'm not sure if he's going to respond to this, but I'm going to put my infantry down there to maybe get some of his troops to attack me. And then I'll be ready with my horsemen. Actually, I should put them in a flank position.
We want to draw him off his hill.
Right.
And obviously we have...
Coming. Okay.
Ekra's gone for the charge. Oh my god, no. So we're setting in our cavalry for the counter charge right now. Ekra has decided that he's going to catch us in the valley while he's weak. He's hit our troops with quite a bit of momentum there as well. So what we're having to do is... send our cavalry in, and the fight is obviously now starting to break out into a bit of mayhem. We do have some archers though, and so they're able to fire into the fight. Mm. Obviously, we can join the battle as well, so if we maybe try and help out some of those troops.
Let me see if I can find Ekra.
Oh, nice. And so we're using the sword which we crafted obviously in this battle as well. It's already doing some damage. The Vlandian Knight Charge is pretty strong, but we've managed to do a pretty good job of taking it down. We still have to deal with those soldiers on the hill though, so if we sort of regroup and make our way back up towards them. Nice. Did we see Ekran at all?
No, I haven't seen.
Okay. It's obviously helpful to take out your enemy commander as well. But he might have already been taken down. Oh! Okay, so let's make our way towards the troops up on the hill and see if we can really push them out of his position.
Ah, they're coming down. Great.
Yeah, it looks like they're going to be joining the charge anyway. They've got a bit of momentum as they come down the hill towards us, but I think we have slightly more troops left on the battlefield. And you can still come on, what are you doing? You can see there's still very much Mountain Blade. If we could dismount here perhaps and get something to the fight as well.
Yeah.
We want to draw all of our troops right now and do sort of the final push. And
it's just a flesh wound.
Take out the last of Ekran's troops. Okay, I think we're just about getting the upper hand.
There we go.
Nice.
I need this. Thank you. Oh.
It just popped up there, earning skill points and stuff. That's still, the whole RPG side is still there. You've got all your skills, you can level up.
Oh no!
Oh!
What happened?
I got messed up.
Okay.
It's cool, a new feature in Bannerlord.
New feature, so when we get taken out, you're no longer forced to sort of go through the simulation. You can watch the rest of the fight. Although we now can't give any more orders, so we're reliant on our troops to take care of the rest of this fight. And we can, of course, finish it quickly and let the simulation play out, but we're also free to watch what's happening. We get some extra information as well if we bring up the tactical screen. We can see exactly how the battle's going. So currently, we're just about winning. The majority of Ekran's army is taken down. We can see how all our troops are doing there as well in terms of the kills they're getting, how many have ran away, how many have been wounded, killed.
And the fact that we've been taken out will have an effect on their morale.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
I think we're doing well enough to see it through, though. We've got quite a few troops left. I think it's just a case of taking down the last few. Here we are, yeah. So the quality of our troops is enough to see us through the battle, and this is going to advance the Southern Empire war effort against the Kingdom of Vlandia. Yeah, great work, guys. Okay, so as we head out now to the post-battle screen, as I mentioned, we get the extra information there. We can see that our Imperial horsemen did particularly well.
Ekran just got wounded. He didn't kill anyone.
Ekran only got one kill. Yeah. How did our allied lord do? Nifon?
One kill.
Not too well either. We didn't do too well, to be honest, so we can't really...
No.
We can't criticize. Okay, so let's head out. And once again, we get to take prisoners. We can upgrade our troops from here as well. Let's just grab a few. Yeah, perfect. And obviously we get much more loot here as well. We can take some of their supplies. We can equip ourselves directly from this screen. Nice. All right, so once we head out, hopefully you can see now how all the different parts of the game, you know, the working economy, the strategic aspect, they all come together and they influence each other. So the battles that we have, they have a much wider impact. Now the Volandian faction is weakened. We can go forward. Maybe we can we'll be able to assault Charas later on. This is actually the end of our demo right now, though. So thank you very much.
We'll have another one tomorrow.
Okay. And if anybody has any questions.
Yeah.
Oh, that's special.
Yeah, we'd love to take some questions.
Is it working? Oh, right.
I can't hear you, sorry.
Try now.
Hi. Oh, there we go. So a bit about the old Mountain Blade and Mountain Blade Warband was it was very mod compatible. So there's a lot of mods for Mountain Blade Warband.
Right.
Will you be having mod tools from launch, or will that be sort of continuing the tradition of having it so freely modded?
Sorry, I just couldn't quite. I know it's about modding, but I couldn't quite hear.
Will there be mods?
Yes. Basically, modability is like greatly expanded. We can also combine multiple mods, so we have a system for that as well. Obviously, what modders are capable of doing in the new engine that we have for the game is you know, above and beyond what we've offered before. So absolutely, of course.
We love mods.
We love mods. Yeah, you know, it's a staple of the series, and we're excited to be bringing them back. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else?
Yeah, it is fantastic to see that the great battle of the Mountain Blade. But there's another question we would like to ask: that is, what's exactly the maximum player or the NPC can fit into the same battle?
Okay, maximum number of troops in the battle.
Yeah.
I'm gonna slightly dodge this question because, well, I mean, it's much more than Warband, and you know, we have an engine which is capable of dealing with much more troops. But we're also trying to balance it out and make sure that the battles are not just large, but also very interesting tactically as well. So we're going for as high as we can, and but we can't say a number right now, unfortunately.
It's not really our focus to.
I mean, we want to make more, but we can't. Yeah. I can't give you a number right now, but definitely more and
just bigger.
And better. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Hi there. So I was wondering, like, when you went up to check out the
Sorry,
other general.
I still just a little bit quiet.
Oh, and when you went up on top of the hill to just look at the other general.
I can't go, sorry.
So, is that better?
Yeah, okay.
Cool, right, okay. You went up to look at the other general and he was sat on top of the hill and he kind of seemed to wait for you to come towards him.
Yeah.
I was wondering what determines the general's strategy and AI in those instances.
Good question. Okay, so what we have is, in addition to sort of like skills that we had in the previous games, lords will have their own personality traits as well. So Ekeren happens to be a sort of lord that plays defensive. You know, he plays his cards close to his chest. So and what he does is he tends to be more passive in battles. Also because in that battle we were the aggressor, it's sort of the onus is on us to attack as well. So you know, he can sort of get away with playing defensive because if we do nothing, then we will just lose the battle in essence. So, you know, does that answer your question?
Yeah, I also wondered though if there was any way that you could, is that message to the player at all, that you understand what sort of general that is before you fight?
We can't show the UI for that right now, but it's in the sort of the in-game encyclopedia that some of that information is communicated. It's also communicated through dialogues and various other ways that the player will be able to understand what kind of person the Lord is. And obviously, the more you play the game, you get to know the different characters, and it will affect how you battle them as well, of course.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks.
I was curious about the crafting system. Usually in old games, like I felt in like Mountain Blade Warband, which I played the most, I felt I had no real need for money other than buying equipment. But with the crafting system, this kind of eliminate that need. Because can you make master crafted equipment, basically? Can you make the top tier equipment without buying it?
The top tier equipment without buying it?
Yeah.
So what we have is I'm not totally sure what the question was, sorry.
As in Warband, you'd have to run around to different towns and stuff if you wanted to get like the best bow, or because you just had to wait for it to spawn. With crafting equipment, will that kind of eliminate that from the game? because I can't found that kind of frustrating.
Well, we don't have crafting. Armors are not crafted. It's just the melee weapons.
Okay.
You know, the way which in which armors are sort of spawned in sort of marketplaces and among merchants is still random. So you're still gonna have to search around to get the top equipment, of course. But what we have is that we don't really have like a best armor, right? You know, there's sort of advantages and disadvantages now. So yeah, obviously you have to explore to still get it the top armors. But with weapons, you can kind of gather them up and then assemble it to create the best weapon that you want.
Yeah. Okay. Cool.
I hope that answers your question. Sorry.
Wanted to ask two things. First, will the crafting system also work in the multiplayer part of the game?
We can't talk about that just yet.
Okay. Makes sense.
Sorry.
And also, how are the political options inside the game? One of the best things of Warban was playing vassals one against the other and starting civil wars, these kind of things.
We have greatly expanded political options. We can't talk about all of them right now, but obviously, the way you use the influence the system to impact different lords and their behavior, that's going to help you can use it to advance your political standing. One new feature we have as well is we have clans within the factions, right? So families, they're kind of grouped together. And so the way that which you have a relationship with one character is going to affect how his brother-in-law thinks of you as well and all that kind of thing. So there's greatly sort of improved and sort of deepened diplomacy in the game, of course.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, so does the feudal system in the Mountain Blade 2 remain the same as the Warband, which is the two-tier feudal system, the king and the vassals? Does that happen the same in Mountain Blade 2, or is it a bit different?
Again, we have the king. Each faction has a sort of a monarchic ruler, and then there's the vassals below that as well.
So there's no system like barons, earl, or...
Well, what you have is they're still ranked as vassal, but I mean, the influence that different lords have in the kingdom is gonna vary based on if they're sort of the owner of a town or just the owner of a village. So that different lords are gonna have different amounts of sort of power and sway in the faction, but they're all lords, yeah.
Oh, right, so they remain the same title.
Yeah.
All right, thank you very much.
Is that all of them? Okay. Anyone else?
Okay. Have we got a release date yet? How long before I'll be able to say, shut up and take my money?
We were waiting for this question. Okay. So we want to have it in some form, whether it's beta or whatever we do, we want to have it in some form in the players' hands this year. That's what we're going for. But it's not a guarantee, but that's what we're shooting for.
Okay, that's good.
Thank
okay,
you.
One more question. Hey.
Right. Hello. Right. So if we take over a faction, for example, the town that's currently on the map. If we want to recruit troops or such from it, will the faction's culture change over time, or will it still be the same as Mountain Blade Warband, where it sticks with one culture regardless of where you take? Like, so you know, in Mountain Blade Warband, if you took over a village, if you took over a castle or town or whatever, the villagers always had the same faction. If you took over a village on Mountain Blade Warband, the factions always had the same culture regardless, like on the villagers. Will that be different on Bannerlord, where if you take over a village, will the factions, will the villagers' culture change, so the troops recruit are different?
The culture is location dependent, so it's you recruit the troops from that area, of course.
All right.
Yeah.
Guys, I want to say, put your hands together and say thanks very much for the team from Mountain Blade.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thanks guys, a lot.